So almost everybody has come in now. Yeah. So pair of straight lines. So let me start with this concept. So if you take two straight lines, let's say I have a line L1 whose equation is AX plus BY plus C equal to 0. And you have another line L2, which is A1X plus B1Y plus C1 equal to 0. And you multiply these two equations in this way. That means you are formulating a joint equation of these two lines in this way. Then this joint equation is basically referred to as the equation of pair of straight lines. Pair of straight lines. I would request everybody to mute their mic. In case you want to speak something, you can unmute yourself and speak out, or you can type it on the chat. Okay. Yeah. Now, so there's a rule by which we actually create this pair of straight lines. In order to create a pair of straight lines, the rule is we must have a zero on one of the sides of the equation. That means you convert it to general form. As you all know, this is called the general form of a equation of a line. AX plus BY plus C equal to 0. So before finding out the pair of straight lines, you should have converted it to general form and then perform this multiplication. If you don't do that, there's something very unusual that will happen. Let me give you an example. Let's say I take a line L1 whose equation is X is equal to Y. Okay. I take another line L2 whose equation is X is equal to minus Y. Okay, you can say y is equal to x or y is equal to minus x. Okay. If you have to create a pair of straight lines from it, we'll first have to bring both the equations to their general form like this. Okay. And then perform the multiplication that would give you the pair of straight lines as x square minus y square equal to 0. So this would be a pair of straight lines. Okay. As you can see, it's a second degree equation. That's why we study this chapter along with conic sections. Now there is another student who decides to not follow this way and directly multiplies L1 and L2. So let me write that in red because he is creating a mistake here. So when you multiply this directly, you'll end up getting x square is equal to minus y square. Correct? And in that case, you'll end up getting something very different. And remember, this is not going to represent a pair of straight lines. In fact, it represents a dot. It represents just 1.0, 0. Getting my point? So please, whenever you are formulating a pair of straight lines, make sure you have converted them to the general form. Right? Any questions with respect to this? Mehul, if you are not able to hear me, rejoin again and select dial in via audio device. Dial in via the device, whichever you are. Are you seeing this on? Okay. Why I'm speaking to him? He's not able to hear me. Rejoin. Dial in via device audio. Okay. Guys, any question with respect to this? If no, I have a very simple question for you all. I'm giving you, sorry, let me write it in yellow once again. So I'm giving you an equation of a pair of straight lines. Very easy question, just as a warm-up question. Hope you can see the screen. X square minus 6xy plus 8y square equal to 0. Tell me, what are the separate equations of the line represented by this equation? I think they're very simple ones. You can type it out on the chat box, but type it privately, not for everyone to see. Let's see who gives the answer for this first. That's correct. Good, Mayit. Rushil, that's one of the lines. Correct. You should completely write down the equation with equal to sign also. Okay. So just write x minus something y is equal to zero, whatever you want to write. Correct, correct, correct. So everybody who is answering me, Rahul, that's correct. Advaik, correct. Very nice. So all you need to do was just factorize it. Okay. Now, while factorizing, don't think there are two variables. You may treat this as a single variable function also if you divide throughout with x square. Okay, so there are multiple ways. One is directly you can just split the terms like minus 4xy minus 2xy plus 8y square. But many people, they don't find this convenient to use. So I'll tell you another method after this. So just take x common, x minus 4y, take minus 2 common, x minus 4y is equal to 0. So that gives us two factors, which is these two. Okay. So basically, it corresponds to two lines. You can say y is equal to x by 2 and y is equal to x by 4. So these two lines jointly have this equation. You have another way to do that. You can actually divide throughout with x squared. So let's say I call this as my first method. Second method is divide throughout with x squared. You'll end up getting something like this. Okay. You may treat y by x to be some other variable. Let me call it as m. Now you all know why I'm calling it as m, because slope, it is something to do with the slope. Well, I'll connect the picture completely a little later on. So when I do that, it gives me a plain and simple quadratic equation where you can apply the splitting of the middle terms just like we did it in the approach one and finish it off. So take 4m, 2m minus 1, take a minus 1, 2m minus 1 equal to 0. So that gives us m equal to half and m is equal to 1/4. Yes. So this can be completed and said that we are dealing with two equations, y by x is equal to half. That means y is equal to x by 2 and y by x equal to 1/4. That is y is equal to x by 4. Okay. Now, a slightly complicated picture. Let's have another example. Let's have another question here. Let me pull out the question for my... Okay. This is a slightly complicated version of the previous question that we had. I hope everybody can read this question. If not, I'll just read this question out for you. Find the combined equation of the straight lines passing through the point 1, 1, right? So it is passing through 1, 1 and parallel to the lines represented by this equation. And parallel to the lines represented by this equation. Just want to see if you are able to extend that concept, whatever you learned just now, to solve this. Else, don't worry, we'll talk more about it. You may use x2 to represent x square in your final answer. Yeah, Karthik, you need to mute your mic. Good morning. Okay, let's see. Anybody? So let me just get it clear for you all. Is the question clear? So there are two straight lines whose combined equation is the one which is given to you on the screen. I want the combined equation of another two straight lines, which are parallel to the lines mentioned here in the equation and passing through 1, 1. So let's say I'm just drawing a rough scenario for this. So let's say the two lines which were represented by x square minus 5xy plus 4y square plus x plus 2y minus 2 equal to 0. This line is represented by these two. Let's say L1 and L2. Okay. Fine. Now I want another two straight lines. Let me draw it in blue, where these straight lines are parallel to the ones which have already been stated in our equation. So as you can see, this is parallel to this, and this is parallel to this. But these two straight lines would be passing through which point? 1, 1. So I want, let me call this as L2 dash and L1 dash combined equation. That's what the question is asking you. Okay, in order to solve this, first of all, we need to see what are the slopes of the lines L1 and L2 from this equation. So from this given equation, I need to see the slopes of the line L1 and L2. Oh, somebody has given me the answer. Absolutely correct. It's Rushil, right? That's brilliant. Absolutely correct. Wonderful. Great, Rushil. Great. So in order to know what are the slopes of L1 and L2, I need to first, in order to know what are the slopes of L1 and L2, we need to work on the second degree terms. So the second degree terms in this equation were these three terms, correct? Yes or no? Now, people ask me, sir, why are you only working with second degree terms? Why not this x, 2y and minus 2? Let me complete this first and I'll tell you why I'm only looking at the second degree terms. By the way, this is factorizable. We all can factorize this. Very easy to factorize. Split the middle terms like this. Take x common. Take a minus 4y common. And this becomes x minus 4y and x minus y. See that I have purposely left some gap over here. Now, why I left this gap over here? Because, see, these second degree terms, they decide about the slopes. The other terms have come because of the presence of some constants over here. So I'm writing it as L and M. So what I'm trying to say here is, if you multiply these two equations, you will end up getting something like a second degree equation like this. Are you getting my point? So when I am trying to solve this equation, I will get something like x minus 4y plus L equal to 0 and x minus y plus M equal to 0. Now what is L and M? I don't care because I don't need them. Only thing that I need are the slopes of these two lines. So the slope of this fellow is 1/4. The slope of this is 1. Correct? Now, if I want to formulate a line which is having the same slopes, so let's say I want to write down the equation of L1 dash. So let's say this is your L1, this is your L2, and I'm writing the equation of L1 dash. So for L1 dash, can I just do this thing? I can just write it as x minus 4y plus p equal to 0. And L2 dash, I can write it as x minus y plus q equal to 0. I just have to replace these constants because we have all learned in our class 11 straight lines chapter that when two lines are parallel, they only differ in their constant terms. If we have, we can easily take the coefficients of x and y to be the same on both the sides. Correct? Is the rationale clear? Why did I choose L1 dash and L2 dash to be these two equations? Any doubt regarding this? Okay. Now, how do I get P and Q? Because unless until I get P and Q, my equation will not be completed. So for that, I would use the fact that these lines must pass through 1, 1. So when I put a 1, 1 here in the L1 dash equation, I get 1 minus 4 plus P is equal to 0. That means P is going to be 3. And in the L2 dash equation, when I do that, I get 1 minus 1 plus Q equal to 0. That means Q is equal to 0. That means the combined equation of these blue lines, or you can say the pair of equations of pair of straight lines given by these blue lines, will hold the equation like this: x minus 4y plus 3 times x minus y equal to 0. Right? You may expand it. You should expand it, in fact, in case they're asking you. So it'll give you x squared minus 5xy plus 4y squared plus 3x. Minus 3y equal to 0. I know this is a slightly challenging problem to take up in the starting itself, but this is what I wanted to set the agenda, that when you're looking at pair of straight lines, you must think them as if there are two separate lines involved. And then how to work around with that problem according to the situation given must be very clear in light of that visualization. Is this clear, everybody? Any doubt, anyone? By the way, good morning to everybody who has joined in late. Please avoid joining late, guys, because a new chapter, initial agenda is missed. You will not understand anything. Okay? Better leave early for the class, but never come late for the class. Okay. So with this, good morning, Shreya. No problem. Anyway, these videos are going to be recorded. So please pay attention from now on so that you don't miss out anything further. Now, something very interesting that has come up from the previous discussions is, remember the first example that I took, x square minus 6xy plus 8y square. It represented two straight lines, which was like this, isn't it? This was our first example. It tells you that, I don't know how many of you observed, if you have a second degree homogeneous equation like this, okay, I use the word called second degree homogeneous equation. What do you understand by this? Okay, first let me speak something about homogeneous equations. Before homogeneous equations, let us understand what is a homogeneous function. What's a homogeneous function? Anybody who has an idea about a homogeneous function? Let's say homogeneous function in two variables. Let me make it more specific. What's a homogeneous function in two variables? So this is something which you are going to use again in the chapter called differential equations, which is going to be taken up towards the month of August or September, where we'll be talking about homogeneous differential equations. So it's very important that you understand this right away. When I say homogeneous function, x, fxy, basically y, because I have taken two variables, so I chose the function name to be f, x, y. So it's just a way of saying that there are two unknowns in this function. So if a function fx, y is a homogeneous equation, homogeneous function, equation, I'll come to it later on. Homogeneous function of degree n, then it will satisfy this particular property. It will satisfy this particular property that if you replace your x with lambda x and y with lambda y, it will end up giving you something like this, where n is the degree of this homogeneous function. Now, this is just a mathematical way of saying something which is very, very easy to understand. It just means that the degree of every term in a homogeneous function will be the same. Example, x square plus y square plus xy. This is an example of a degree 2 homogeneous function. Okay, so if I call this as fxy, you can see that it will satisfy this property. So change your x with lambda x, change your y with lambda y. That means you are going to change it in the entire function. And you will see that you can pull out a lambda square throughout common. Okay, that is your function becomes lambda square times fxy. Okay, this is just a mathematical notation, dear friends. Don't like, you know, take it very, very like it's a rocket science concept, something like that. No, it's a simple thing. So now talking about homogeneous equations. So if a function is related, if a homogeneous function is equated to some, you know, let's say zero, it becomes a homogeneous function. So here, if you see, this is a homogeneous equation of degree 2. Now my claim is a second degree equation. My claim here is that a second degree, please read these statements very, very carefully. A second degree homogeneous equation will always represent a pair of straight lines passing through the origin. Passing through origin means what? Intersecting each other at origin. Okay, passing means intersecting each other at origin. Now, why do I make such a claim? So let me take, see guys, I'm not claiming that my both the lines will always be real, right? But I'm claiming that they may be non-real, they may be the same line squared up, they may be two distinct lines, but they will always represent a pair of straight lines passing through origin. So let us say I take a general second degree, I take a homogeneous second degree equation like this. Okay. So what I can do is I can first take a B common, something like this. Okay. Then I'll divide throughout with x square. Very similar to the second approach which I had taken while solving the first problem. Okay. And then what I'll do is I will treat this as if it's a quadratic in y by x. Okay. So if it's a quadratic in y by x, let's say it has roots m1 and m2. So this entire thing could be factorized something like this. Are you getting this point? So this is a quadratic, the part which I have shown with the curly brackets. That is a quadratic in y by x. And I'm assuming that m1 and m2 are the roots of that quadratic. So this can be factorized just like we factorize a quadratic equation like this. Okay, giving us two situations. One is y by x could be m1 or y by x could be m2, which means y is equal to m1x and y equal to m2x are the two lines which actually make this pair of straight lines equation. And you can see that they pass through origin, or you can say they intersect through origin. They pass through the origin. Now, I'm not claiming M1, M2 will always be real. M1, M2 may be imaginary also. M1, M2 may be equal also. M1, M2 may be real and distinct also. Okay. In those cases, we'll get different types of lines. So if M1 and M2 are real and distinct, we will get two real lines. We'll get two real and distinct lines, let me say. That means something like this you will see. Okay. So you'll see them intersecting each other, and this intersection will happen at origin. if your M1 and M2 are real and equal, guys, don't waste too much time on writing these stuffs. I'll be sending the PDF to you on the group. Okay, focus on understanding and feel free to unmute yourself and ask me questions. If M1 and M2 are real and equal, that means it represents two same lines, or you can say it's the same line, two real and same lines, or you can say coincident lines. Coincident lines. Okay, so the two lines will be one above the other. So one is, let's say, this white one, other will be right on top of it. Okay, so there's no difference between these two lines. And if M1, M2 happens to be non-real or imaginary, then we'll get two imaginary lines. So the last case, we are not going to talk about it. We are only going to talk about the first two cases. These are important for us, not the last one. Any question with respect to this?
Sir, if they're imaginary, how do we know that it's even a pair of straight lines?
See, the roots of it will be imaginary. Just like we can have imaginary circles, we can have imaginary lines also. But the idea is you cannot represent them on the Cartesian coordinate plane. Getting the point, Ruchir?
Yes.
So the representation is not possible. In order to represent something which is imaginary, we cannot represent it on a real plane, or you can say Cartesian plane. Cartesian plane is a real plane. Okay.
So can we represent them on an Arden plane?
You can represent an Arden plane, but now then you have to write things in terms of, you know, Z and all. Yes, you can represent it in the Arden plane. Now, one more thing which is very obvious from this exercise is that we learned that if this represents two straight lines, y is equal to m1x and y is equal to m2x, m1 plus m2 can be written as minus 2h by b. Now, how did I get this? Let me go back to the previous slide. Okay, so here you can see that this equation has roots m1 and m2, right? So we know sum of the roots is minus b by a, correct? Remember Vita's relation? Let me write it. Vita's relation. I mean, it's just a name of the person who came up with this. We have been doing this since class 10th only. Sum of the roots of a quadratic equation minus b by a. Product of the roots of a quadratic equation, C by A. The same thing I'm going to use over here. So if let's say this is my equation, I can say M1 plus M2 here would be, this is going to be your B. A is 1 over here. So minus B by A. Okay. And M1 and M2 would be equal to C. This is your C and A is 1. So that's going to be A by B. So that's what I'm going to write in the next slide. So follow this up in the next slide. This result is to be kept in mind. Very, very important result. Please keep this result in mind because it will be required in a lot of problem solving. Remember this.
So H is just any constant, or does it have any particular value?
See, in a variable, what role does X and Y play? It plays the role of all the coordinates that are present on that line.
Yeah.
Correct. So in the same way, this represents two such lines, right? One of the lines is given by this, another line is given by this. So the role of X and Y is the same as role of any coordinate present on that particular line. In this case, present on a pair of straight lines.
So no, I was asking about H.
Oh, H.
Yeah.
What is the role of H?
Like, is it another just variable or like a constant?
It is a constant. See,
okay.
These terms would be mentioned to you in the question. Don't worry.
Okay.
This is not a variable. A, H and B will be some constants which would be given to you in the question itself.
Okay.
Just like in the previous example, when I gave you x square minus 6xy plus y square equal to 0, sorry, 8y square equal to 0.
Okay. So just 3 there.
Yeah, A minus was 3. 1, H was minus 3, minus and 3, yeah. B was 8. Okay. So by using these relations, you can know the sum of the slopes of the two lines and product of the slopes of the two lines which constitute that pair. Idea is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, another important thing that we'll be taking up here is, when do we get real and distinct lines? When do we get coincident lines? And when do we get imaginary lines? So from here, in this entire exercise, we can use our quadratic equation formula. Okay, so we know that this line could be written as, this pair of straight lines could be written as something like this. Sorry, this is going to be just y by x. Correct? Now, the quadratic equation formula says that y by x, that is your slope, that is m1 and m2, could be given as minus b plus minus b square, that is 4h square by b square, minus 4ac, correct? So 4a is 1, so c is going to be this, okay? Divided by 2a. Now, if you want your m1 and m2 to be both real and distinct, we can say the term within the under roots, that is this term, must be greater than 0, isn't it? Which actually gives us x square minus 4ab greater than 0.
Not so it can be greater than equal to
ab. No, if you want real and distinct.
Oh, real and distinct.
Distinct, yeah. Okay. So this condition, when your h square minus ab, you already know your h, you already know your a, you already know your b from the lines equation. If you find that h square minus ab is greater than 0, that means the lines which constitute this. For example, in this case, if you check 3 square minus 1 into 8, isn't it greater than 0? That means this will give me two real lines, L1 and L2, which are distinct. So real and distinct lines. In the same way, if your h square minus ab is equal to 0, it will give you coincident lines. Okay? And if your h square is less than ab, that is h square minus ab is less than 0, you will end up getting imaginary lines. Okay, this h square minus ab term is very useful. We'll come across this term later on also when we are talking about angle between the lines. Meanwhile, if this concept is clear, I have a question for all of you. Ready? Anybody who is copying something? Should we move on to the next question? Okay. Here it goes. If the slope of one of the lines represented by ax square plus 2hxy plus by square equal to 0 be n times the slope of the other, then which of the condition here is true? So it's a single option. The first is 4n square h square is equal to ab 1 plus n the whole square. Option B says 4n h square is equal to ab 1 plus n. Option C, 4 n h square is ab 1 plus n the whole square. And option D, 4n square h square is AB 1 plus n. Okay, either you can reply to me privately or I will run a poll over here. Okay, those who are answering, please do it privately. At the same time, please hit on the poll button also so that I know how many people have given the right answer. So just two of the people have responded so far. Take your time, guys. No need to rush. I'm allowing 1.5 minutes for this question. It's not more than worth more than that. Richard, I'll disclose the answer after everybody is done, or most of the people are done. Guys, 10 seconds more. Chala, I'll give you 2 minutes. Only 7 of you have voted so far. Okay, so I can see responses coming from Ruchir, both the Ruchirs, Vikas, Sai Vaidya. Okay, guys. Time up, end of poll. You can see the result on your screen. Most of the people have replied with option C. Okay, let's discuss this. So you're claiming that one of the lines has a slope n times the slope of the other. So we can do one thing. We can say, let the slope be m1 and let the other slope be nm1. Okay, so instead of assuming m1 and m2, we know already that the sum of the slopes, that is m1 plus m2, is minus 2h by b. So that's our first equation. The product of the slopes, that is n1 into n times n1, is a by b. That's my second equation. Correct? So now what we can say is from the first equation, m1 could be written as minus 2h by b 1 plus n. If you take a m1 common, 1 plus n will factor out over here, which will come down. Okay. And this substitute it into. If you put that into n m1 square will be minus 2h by b 1 plus n the whole square. That's going to be a by b. Okay. So let's try to simplify this further. So n times 4h square by b square 1 plus n the whole square is equal to a by b. B and b will get cancelled. Take the entire denominator to the right hand side. You get 4n h square is equal to a b 1 plus n the whole square. Which option matches? Yes, option C matches with this. So option C is the right answer. Well done. Any question regarding this? So knowing these formulas really help your case. We'll move on to the next question now. This question I'm going to project on the screen. I'm not going to write it down. Okay, hope you can see the question. If the slope of one of the lines represented by this be the nth power of the other, then prove this. So since this is the prove that question, just type done if you're done. Oh, Sure, Kritika. Guys, I just need to go back to the previous slide for a second to help Kritika out. Kritika, let me know once you're done seeing this.
Yeah, sir, I'm done.
Okay, Kritika, thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. It's Karthik. My bad. Sorry, Karthik. Ruchir is done. Param is done. Vikas is done. Good guys. It's just a 2 minute question. Should not take more than that. Mohit is done, Sai is done. Done. Just 30 seconds more for others to wrap up. Anush is also done. Hi Abhiram, Mehul, request you to mute your mics please. Yeah, thank you. Okay guys, chalo, let's discuss. Kirtan, Dhruv, Kirtika, all are done. Okay. So this again, very simple case. Let's say one of the slopes is m, other is m to the power n. Okay, the sum of the slopes is given as minus 2h by b and product of the slopes is known to be a by b. Okay, so from the last equation here, I can say m to the power n plus 1 is a by b. So we can say m is n plus 1th root of a plus b. Correct? Just substitute this in the first one, you'll end up getting a by b to the power of 1 by n plus 1. And a by b to the power of n by n plus 1 is equal to negative 2h by b. Okay, let me multiply with b throughout. And pull out a take the minus 2h to the left hand side, so it becomes b times a by b to the power of 1 by n plus 1 plus b times a n plus 1 and plus 2h equal to 0. If you simplify this, remember b is there in the denominator, so the power of b will get subtracted from 1, so it will become 1 minus 1 by n plus 1 into a to the power 1 by n plus 1. Similarly here, b to the power 1 minus n by n plus 1 into a to the power n by n plus 1 plus 2h equal to 0. So just simplify this. This becomes b to the power n by n plus 1, a to the power 1 by n plus 1, b to the power again 1 by n plus 1, a to the power n by n plus 1 plus 2h equal to 0. You can take, in this case, a, b to the power n common and raise whole thing to the power of 1 by n plus 1. Here you can take a to the power n, b common and raise the whole thing to the power of 1 by n plus 1 plus 2h equal to 0. Okay. And this is what we wanted to prove. Okay. This is the result. Yeah, this is the result. Is that fine? Very simple activity. Nothing difficult about it. Okay, moving on to the next question. Let me pull that question out. Okay. This is a question which is again a subjective type, but I'll give you some options so that you know you don't have to type too much. So the question says, find the condition that one of the lines given by this pair of straight lines may be perpendicular to one of the lines given by this. Okay. What are the conditions? I will just write it down for you. You just have to choose which one is correct. So option A, 4 H dash A dash H dash B dash Okay, this is option A. Option B is option C is option D is none of these. I'll run a poll for this. Let's have 3 minutes to solve this question. Okay, so we have response coming from one of the students. Again, read the question very carefully. One of the lines is perpendicular to one of the lines of this. It's just one answer I've got. We have just 15 seconds left. I think I can extend this to 4 minutes. Okay, one more response I have got. Okay, time up. I would now request everybody to press any one of the options that you feel. I mean, let's say you're taking a chance and you have to press one of the buttons. So press that button now so that we can start the discussion. Okay, Sai, we'll discuss it. Okay, so okay. Cool. So we'll stop the poll here and let me show you the poll result. The poll result says almost 74% people have voted for option B. Okay, let's check whether B is correct or not. Now guys, how to approach this problem? Many of you would be struggling with that. So let us say one of the lines from this particular, let me just change my ink color. So let's say one of the lines is Y is equal to MX. Okay, so can I say a line perpendicular to it, right, and passing through origin? Now how do I know passing through origin? Because this is a homogeneous second degree equation. So can I say y is equal to minus 1 by mx would be a line which will satisfy this particular pair of straight lines? So if this satisfies this, then this must satisfy the other one. This is the core principle that we'll be using to solve this question. So I'm going to write it over here. So if I say let y is equal to mx be a pair of straight lines that satisfy, let's say this is one of the lines which satisfies ax square plus 2hxy plus by square equal to 0. That means I can substitute my y as mx into this and write it as something like this. Okay, which means a plus 2hm plus bm square equal to 0. Okay, let me write it in a decreasing degree of m. So this is a quadratic which will be satisfied by this m. Okay, so a line perpendicular to this, that is y is equal to minus 1 by mx, should satisfy the other homogeneous second degree equation. Correct? No, that is nothing but it must satisfy a dash x square 2h dash xy and b dash y square. So here also I can do the same thing which I had done with the previous one. I can substitute y with minus x by m. So this will become a dash x square 2h dash x minus 1 by mx plus b dash minus 1 by mx the whole square equal to 0. Okay, just drop an x square term from everywhere and write it in descending powers of m. So we'll have a dash m square minus 2h dash m plus b dash equal to 0. So this is my second quadratic that I have. Now what do I claim here, my dear? I claim that both these equations must have one common root m. So 1 and 2 must have one common root at least. Correct? So what are the conditions that we can use when two quadratic equations have one root in common? We can do one thing. We can treat our m square for the time being as x, m to be something like y, and get two linear equations from them. That means what I'm trying to say is that, right, let me write it like this. So one equation. Other equation. And I will solve for x and y. So if you solve for x and y, you'll be able to solve for m also, correct? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my cross multiplication method that I had learned in my class 10th. Everybody learned cross multiplication method? Okay. It's a method that we use to solve simultaneous equations, correct? We'll learn this in determinants chapter once again. It is basically known as the Cramer's rule. Okay, how does it work? So under x, I have left some, you know, gap. So in that gap, what I'll do, I will hide the column in which x falls. So I'll hide this column. Let me show you. This column is hidden. And I'll do a cross multiplication. So 2h multiplied with b dash and minus 2h dash multiplied with a and subtract them. So something like this. 2hb dash plus 2h dash b, sorry, h dash a. Got it? You recall this method? You had done this in class 10th. In the same way, for y, what will I write? I'll do a cross multiplication of these two guys. So bb dash minus aa dash. And for one, again, we'll do a cross multiplication of this with. So minus 2h dash b minus 2h a dash. Okay. Is this clear, everybody? Are you happy so far with these steps? Let me know. Any doubt, please highlight.
Yes, sir.
Anybody? Okay, I'm not naming people here. So if you, in case you have any doubt, please stop me right over here. Okay, so everybody is fine. So what I'll do is first, I'll just change this to plus and reverse the order in which I have written this. So change this to plus, so I'll write a dash minus bb dash. And moreover, I will also change my x. X was m square and y was m. So I'll change this to m square and I'll change this to m. Okay, so from this equation, what I'm circling out over here, I can say m is equal to a dash minus b b dash by negative 2h dash b plus 2h a dash. And from this equation, let me show it in the white color, this equation. Sorry for making all those amoeba type of structures over here. So from that equation, I can say m square, let me write it in white, m square is 2hb dash plus 2h dash a by negative of 2h dash b plus 2h a dash. Now clearly, this expression, that is the expression in the white, is square of the expression in the yellow. Because one is the representation for m square and other is the representation for m. So can I not write the square of this equal to this? So if I do that, let me move slightly to the right of the screen. So from here, I'm continuing. So if I write the square of it, we'll end up seeing something like this. 2h b dash plus 2h dash a by negative 2h dash b plus 2h a dash is square of this guy. So a dash minus b b dash square by 2h dash b plus 2h a dash square. Now, instead of writing square, I can just cancel off one of the terms, okay? Cross multiply and bring it to one side. You'll end up seeing something like this. 4 HB dash H dash A times H dash B plus HA dash plus AA dash minus BB dash square equal to 0. I think this matches with what do you think? This matches with option? Option C it matches with.
Option C,
yes. And what was the poll result? The poll result was maximum people said B. So most of you went wrong there. Now this taught me one more thing other than pair of straight lines concept. The condition for two quadratics to have common roots. Guys, that chapter is also on our agenda in the summer break. Acha, before I move on, what's going on in your schools? So how many schools are there here in the session? HSR is there, Indranagar is there. Guys, can you just type it out? One person? If any other school, I think Akansha is also there. What is going on in your school? HSR guys.
Sir, right now we're doing differentiation and continuity.
Differentiation and continuity. Acha. Indranagar is doing integrals. Right. I know Indranagar always starts with integration. I don't know why. Okay. Karthik, JSS didn't start the classes. Okay. Badly affected by Corona, it seems. Matrices and determinants in Freedom International. My God. Guys, don't worry about these chapters right now. We'll have enough time to cover them up. So it's very important to pay attention to these concepts, which we are going to miss out if you don't do them now. Okay. Well, I have another question for you all. Mehul didn't start classes. Okay. No worries. Oh, the summer vacation is already on.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I was under the impression that they can reopen once this issue settles down. Okay, never mind. That's a good thing, actually. Okay, guys, next question for all of you. If two of the three lines, see, I'm just making the questions more challenging now. If two of the three lines represented by AX cube, BX square, Y, CXY square plus DY cube. Now, from the previous concepts, we can easily say that this would represent three lines, all of them meeting at origin. So it's a cubic homogeneous equation now. So what does the question say? If two of these three straight lines represented by this are at right angles. That means are perpendicular. Then which of the following option is correct? A square plus AC plus BD plus D square equal to 0. Option B, B square plus AC plus CD plus A square is equal to 0. Option C, C square plus AB plus BD plus D square equal to 0. And option D, A square plus AC plus CD plus D square equal to 0. I'll run the poll once again. Guys, in case the poll result is coming in front of your screen, do let me know, because it normally tends to block the screen. Okay. So if it blocks your screen, let me know. I'll remove it. Let's have 2 minutes for this question. Time has already started. Do we need to do that, Sai? That is the first question. We don't need to pick up these equations. It can be done without going into those complexities. Akansha, why you are not able to see the poll? Are you... is everybody able to see the poll?
Yes, sir.
Try joining again, Akansha. I think you should be able to. Hope you're not seeing it on a mobile phone, because mobile phone will completely block the screen. Anyways, you can answer me on the chat also. Poll is just want to see how many people are giving right options, right answers. Guys, we'll take a break at 11:15, okay? Okay, two responses I have got so far. 2 minutes is already over. Don't worry, Sai, we'll discuss it. Okay, I'll give you a minute more. Everybody, have a minute more. Okay, Richard. Guys, come on, 15 seconds more.
So can we get like 30 seconds more?
Okay, fine. Let's have 30 seconds more. But after 30 seconds, everybody should test one of the options. Not required, Kritika. Don't worry about it. Just give your best shot. We'll discuss it. Once I've got sufficient number of responses, we'll discuss it. Correct, Ruchir. That's a good idea, actually. Okay, we are almost touching 4 minutes. Guys, everybody, please press one of the options on your poll. Start pressing it. Take a leap of faith. Let's see how lucky you are. Everybody, just 13 people have responded. Guys, everybody, all 28 of you. Never mind, Vikas. Okay, let me end the poll now. So you can see the poll results. 47% of you have said option A. Okay. Then C and then D, of course. Okay, so let's look into this. See, again, try to treat this as if you are dealing with a cubic equation in Y by X. Okay, so treat this as a cubic equation in Y by X, because Y by X will act as your slope. Okay, so when you replace, when you just take X cube common or divide throughout with X cube, you see something like this. Dy by X cube, you'll have Cy by X square, you'll have By by X, and you'll have A. Okay, replace your Y by X with M if you want, So this is a cubic. This is a cubic in M, which will have three roots, M1, M2, and M3, let's say. So let's say these are the roots of this cubic equation. Okay. Now read the question. Two of these are perpendicular. That means, let's say M1 and M2 are perpendicular. Can I say they'll be multiplying to give you minus one? Okay. Now again, use beta's relation. Beta's relation, let's use. So in beta's relation, it says M1 plus M2. By the way, I'll write down that relation completely. In fact, so that everybody is clear. The sum of the roots, just like we had it in quadratic, minus b by a, here I will get minus c by d. Okay. Product of roots two at a time, that is m1, m2, m2, m3, m3, m1. Okay. Any other possibility? No. That would be equal to this term, that is b by d. Okay. And finally, the product of all of them will be equal to minus a by d. So see how alternating sign it takes. Minus c by d, plus b by d, minus a by d. Just like we have minus a by a, c by a, you are extending that to incorporate a cubic equation. Okay. People who are not aware of such relations, please read through this. You will find this in any JEE textbook. Talking about theory of equations. Now, from the last equation over here, can I say M1 into M2 is minus 1. So minus 1 times M3 is minus A by D, which means M3 itself is A by D. And since we know M3 is a root of this equation, M3 should satisfy that equation. So I will substitute M3 as A by D in your, let me call this as the first equation, and whatever I get should be my result. So d times m cube means m3 cube, because m is a root, correct? Isn't it? So m3 will be replaced in place of m, plus c times a by d square, plus b times a by d, plus a equal to 0. Okay. So let me just simplify this further. So this becomes a cube by d square, a square c by d square, ab by d, plus a equal to 0. Let me drop a factor of a throughout. So one of the a's I'll just drop off. So this will become a square. This will become an a. This will go off. This will become a 1. Okay. And I'll multiply throughout with d square. If I multiply throughout with d square, this is what I obtain. And this is nothing but which of your options? Option A.
Option A.
Option A, absolutely. Is that fine, everybody? So it just involves the use of beta relation and just substituting one of the roots in that cubic equation. So wow, that was enough number of problems that we have taken to understand the nitty-gritties of the basic concepts. So now we'll move on to the next subtopic under this, which is the angle between the pair of straight lines. Angle between the pair of straight lines. The pair of straight lines given by a second degree homogeneous equation. So still we are dealing with homogeneous only. Don't worry, we'll take up a general second degree equation in some time, but let us first try to master this second degree equation only. That means I'm dealing with only those lines which are passing through origin. Pair of straight lines passing through origin. Okay. Now, so let's say these are the two lines, and I'm talking about the acute angle theta between them. So guys, let me tell you, we do not know their equation separately. If you know the equation separately, so let's say this was y is equal to m1x and this was y equal to m2x. I don't think so anyone of us would have taken any longer to get the answer like this, isn't it? Remember your class 11th pair of straight lines, angle between the two straight lines whose slopes are m1, m2 is given by mod m1 minus m2 by 1 plus m1, m2. Okay, so here I'm assuming my theta is an acute angle. Okay, this formula is known to everybody. Anybody who is seeing this formula for the first time? Now, unfortunately, m1 and m2 are not known to me separately. I know them as a combination. That means I know what is m1 plus m2. What is that? Minus 2h by b. Don't forget these results. And I know their product. What is that? A by b. So from this expression, can I get my result of tan theta completely in terms of h, a and b? Let's try that out. So the numerator part, by the way, somebody mumbled something. Any question? So the numerator part, if you see, mod of m1 minus m2 could be written as m1 plus m2 the whole square minus 4m1 m2. Correct? Denominator I would not disturb. Why will not disturb the denominator? Because m1 and m2 term is already known to us. Yeah. Is that fine? So now I'm going to just make these subtle replacements. So m1 and m2. Any question, anybody? Correct, Uchir, correct. So now I'm going to make these replacements over here. So I'll end up getting under root. M1 plus m2 square will be the square of this term, which is 4h square by b square minus 4 m1 m2 is a by b, so 4a by b by the way, I don't need a mod here because under root outcome is always positive, so 1 plus a by b. Okay, we can further simplify this by taking 4 out of the under root sign, so that will come out as a 2, multiply by b square in the numerator term, so you'll end up getting h square minus ab, and that b will eat away the b of the denominator, so that will become a plus b. Please note down this result because we need to remember this.
I think I understand the last step.
This step, okay. So 4 I took out common.
After that, the denominator, how does it become a plus b?
Okay, so I multiplied. See, what I did here was I multiplied with a b square in the denominator, in the numerator and denominator. So this was the LCM, correct? Okay, and yeah. This under root sign will come down as mod b, correct? So this will come out of the under root sign as mod b. So this is gone now. Okay, and this mod b here from here will cancel off this mod b outside. So here you can write it as b whole divided by mod b. Okay, so this and this will get cancelled off. So leaving you with this result.
Okay.
Clear? Okay. Again, this expression was known to us before also. Remember when we were talking about the lines being real and distinct, the lines being coincident, and the lines being imaginary? So here you can see that if h square minus ab is positive, you will have some finite, you can say, non-zero angle between the lines, correct? That means your lines will have something like this. Okay, so this is your angle between the lines. If h square minus ab is zero, note that the lines will be parallel, but more specifically, they will be coincident. So they will lie on top of each other. So I'm just drawing them very close to each other. So yellow and white lines will be exactly overlapping on each other. Why am I saying that it is coincident, not parallel? Because theta equal to zero can also mean parallel, right? But why I'm saying coincident?
So because even the intercept is the same.
Because they are passing through origin. So they are both passing through origin. So it cannot happen that they are parallel and they are both passing through the same point. It cannot happen. So they have to be coincident. Okay. And if h square minus ab is negative, the angles themselves, because the lines are imaginary, you will not have a real angle there. Another important thing that comes out from this exercise is that if a plus b is zero, it implies that the lines are perpendicular. Okay. We say this as, if coefficient of x square in the equation of the pair of straight lines plus the coefficient of y square in the equation of the pair of straight lines add up to give you zero, that means the lines comprising that pair of straight lines are perpendicular. So the lines are perpendicular. Is that clear? I think this concept we have used in past to solve locus questions. So I'll write it down, useful for solving locus questions.
So, but a plus b is in the denominator, right? So if it's zero, won't it become like, would it be infinity?
So tan theta would be infinity.
Yeah, tan theta would be infinity.
Tan theta would be, okay. Yeah.
Okay. Let's have a question on this. Okay, hope you can read this question. Find the angle between the lines whose combined equation or whose pair of lines equation is given by this. Or let me reframe this question. Prove that the angle between the two lines, prove that the angle between the two lines, this value is going to be 2 alpha, where alpha is this value. So that you can know whether you have done it correctly or not. So prove that the angle between the lines represented by this second degree equation, by the way, it's a second degree homogeneous equation, will be 2 alpha. Let's have 2.5 minutes for this. It's just trigonometry, guys, nothing else. Just do your basic identities, take care of your basic trigonometric identities properly, and you'll be done.
Could you repeat the question? My connection went off.
Do you want me to say repeat anything for you?
Yes, sir. I couldn't hear the question at all.
The question was, you have to prove that the angle between the lines whose combined equation is given by this is 2 alpha. Okay. Instead of find, I have given you to prove it so that you know that you're going correct. Type done once you're done so that we can discuss it. Done, Vikas. Okay. But I'm also done. Nice. Last 30 seconds, guys. So are you also done? Chaitanya done? Okay. First, let us write this in our ax square 2hxy by square equal to 0 form. Okay, so I'll collect coefficients of x square. Just let me know in case I miss out on any term. The coefficient of x square, I'll not expand it. I can directly pick out from here. It would be sine square alpha coming from this term minus cos square beta. Okay. And xy term. Let me write down the xy term. Xy term would be 2xy sine beta cos beta. And y square term would have sine square alpha. And from here, I'll get sine square beta also. Okay. So this is playing the role of my A. Okay. This is playing the role of my H, if I'm not mistaken. And this is playing the role of my B. So I know the formula that tan of theta would be under root of 2 under root of h square minus ab by a plus b. Guys, from my experience, I have seen people tend to forget this too. Don't do that. Okay. So let me write it down. So h square would be sine square beta cos square beta minus ab. Ab would be this. It's all about, you know, simplifying your this thing. So it'll be mod of a plus b. Okay. So this ugly expression you get. Okay. So what I'll do is I'll just try to simplify this further. So in the numerator, you'll end up getting sine square beta, cos square beta. You'll end up getting negative sine to the power 4 alpha minus sine square alpha, sine square beta, minus sine square alpha, cos square beta. And you'll end up getting plus sine square beta, cos square beta. Okay. In the denominator, we'll end up seeing 2 sine square alpha minus 1. Let me know if I have missed out on anything. Okay, done, Ruchir also. If you open the brackets, you'd realize that this term and this term would stand cancelled off. Okay. In these two terms, if I take sine square alpha common, I'll get a 1. So you will finally see this result coming up. Sine square alpha minus sine to the power 4 alpha by mod of 2 sine square alpha minus 1. Okay, so let's do one thing. Let's introduce everything inside the under root sign. So I'll have sine square alpha and you'll have 1 minus sine square alpha. Guys, we know that if it is mod, we can switch the position of these two terms and nothing will happen. We can also write this as like this, isn't it? Yes or no? And isn't this actually cos of 2 alpha? So inside it will go as cos square of 2 alpha. Let me introduce this 2 inside also. So that the numerator could be written as under root 4 sine square alpha cos square alpha by cos square 2 alpha, which is under root of sine square of 2 alpha by cos square of 2 alpha. Okay. That is nothing but tan of 2 alpha. In fact, okay. And so theta has to be 2 alpha, which is what we were required to prove. It's just a, you know, a trigonometric identity application, nothing else. There was no merit in this problem. Okay. So now we are going to move on to the concept of equation of the angle bisectors angle bisectors of a pair of straight lines given by this homogeneous second degree. So we are still stuck with the homogeneous one only. So now my question is, let's say these blue lines represent my pair of straight lines given by this equation. Okay. Let's say L1 and L2 are those two pair of straight lines. Now I want to get the equation of the bisectors of these angles. So let me use some different color here. Let me use orange. So these orange lines that you see here, they are the bisector lines. Let me call them as B1 and B2. So what do I want here? I want the combined equation of the angle bisectors, just like you, there's a combined equation of L1 and L2. How will I get this? So for that, I would again use my concept that we had discussed in class 11th in straight lines. If you choose any point H, K on the bisector, can I say that perpendicular distance of that point from the two lines L1 and L2 would be equal? And it doesn't matter. Even if you choose here also H, K, this distance, sorry for that crooked line, will be equal to this distance, isn't it? So this is the underlining principle on which we are going to derive the combined equation. Guys, again, I'm repeating. I don't want their equation separately. I'm dealing with their pair of equations. Okay. So I'll use my basic distance of a point from a line formula. So I'll assume first that let y is equal to m1x and y is equal to m2x be these two straight lines represented by this equation. There's so many ways we can do it, Ruchir, but I would like to take up the shortest and most convenient way. Okay, so now, can I say the distance of h, k from L1 will be k minus m1h by under root of 1 plus m1 square mod of it? This distance should be equal to the distance of h, k from the other line L2, which is mod of k minus m2h by under root of 1 plus m2 square. Right? This is the distance formula I'm using, guys, so don't be surprised. So how did I get this expression? It is from the distance formula. Anybody who doesn't know the distance formula, let me know right now so that I can write it down for you. Okay. Now, without loss of time, without, you know, wasting time, can we replace my k with y and h with x? Because sooner or later we'll have to do that. So let me replace it right over here. Sorry, m2. Okay, now we have to square both the sides and bring it to a second degree homogeneous equation. So let me square and cross multiply. So I'm directly writing those steps over here. So 1 plus m2 square y minus m1 x square, okay, minus 1 plus m1 square y minus m2 x square equal to 0. Okay, now I'll be simplifying this. Pay attention while I'm simplifying this. I'm going to handpick my terms and write them. So first of all, let me write down my y square term. Okay. So y square term, okay, will have coefficients 1 plus m2 square minus 1 plus m1 square. So can I say m2 square minus m1 square? You can also do this simplification at your end also. You don't have to follow me for that. Next, I will take minus x square common, and for that I will have again m2 square minus m1 square. Remember, m1 square, m2 square will get cancelled. So you'll be only left with m1 square multiplied to 1 and m2 square multiplied to 1. Okay, so this will be the expression. And my other terms like xy, I will have 2xy m2 minus m1 minus 2 m1 m2 m2 minus m1. Let me just shift it to the right. Equal to 0. Just check if I have missed out on any expression. This is a minus sign. I'll write it once again. This is minus m1. Okay. So from this entire expression, I can drop off m2 minus m1. So m2 minus m1 could be dropped off because we know it's not going to be 0. So I'm dealing with such lines where m1 and m2 are distinct. So m1 minus m2 cannot be 0. So I'm dropping off that factor from everywhere. So that will give me, I'm just clubbing y square minus x square also together. So I'll be left with m2 plus m1. Okay. Here I will end up getting 2xy 1 minus 2 m1 m2. Please remember, I have dropped, I'll write it here, I have dropped the factor of m2 minus m1. Cool enough? Any doubt here? Now, we already know the values of m1 plus m2, and that is minus 2h by b. Okay. We also know, by the way, let me take it to the other side. So 2xy, 2m1 m2 minus 1. Okay. By the way, I should not have reversed the sign. I should have dropped this guy, drop this negative sign and maintain the same order. Okay, any doubt in this simplification so far? And this m1, m2, I'm going to write as, what is m1, m2? A by B. A by B, correct. Let's also drop some other factors. Just a second. I think this, there will not be a 2 here. 2 is already taken common out. Okay. I'm sorry. 2 was already taken common out here. That's why by mistake I had introduced a 2 here. Now this 2 and this 2, just drop them off. So you have y square x square h by b is equal to xy b minus a by b. B and b also could be dropped off. You can write this as x square minus y square by b minus a is equal to xy by h. And this further could be, just for the purpose of, you know, writing x before y, we can write it like this. Please remember this equation going forward. You will not have time to derive them in your exam condition. Please remember this, very, very useful. The equation of the pair of bisectors of, so this is the equation of pair of bisectors of the given line, given pair of lines, ax square plus 2hxy plus by square. So this line's pair of bisectors, that means your orange line equations would be these. These would be your orange lines. Note it down. More importantly, it should be there. The picture of it should be there in your mind. Okay, one quick analysis over here. What is the coefficient of x square in the equation of the pair of bisectors?
H.
1 by a minus b. Equation, a coefficient of x square. What is that? 1 by a minus b only, no?
Yeah.
Okay. What is the coefficient of y square in this? Minus 1 by a minus b. And if you add them, what will happen? If you add them, what will happen?
Zero.
What is it?
Perpendicular.
It means they are perpendicular, which is very obvious, no? Because we have also done this in class 11, that your bisectors will always be perpendicular to each other. Yes or no? So this is how we can actually see whether our result, or verify whether our result is correct or not. Now, answer this question that I'm going to ask you. What will happen if A is equal to B? How would this equation change? Would you say undefined?
Yeah, undefined.
No, guys.
No, sir. It's just become not 0, 0. X
square equals y square. X square equal to y square. H by x will be 0.
Right, right. Correct.
H will be 0.
If A is equal to B, this equation just converts to x square minus y square equal to 0. That means y is equal to x and y equal to minus x would act as the pair of bisectors. Okay. See, later on in your 3D chapter, you would study about 3D equations. There you would see such weird expressions. I'm just giving you a dummy example. So this zero is not an operational. This is not an operation. This is not an operation that you're performing. This is symbolic. Okay. So you can have such equations in 3D lines. You'll study it soon in the month of early October or September. You'll study that. So presence of a zero here doesn't mean this equation has become undefined. It's just another way of saying that x square minus y square will be zero. In the same way, if H is zero, it just means your pair of bisectors would have XY equal to zero, which is actually your X-axis and Y-axis equations. So your bisectors would be the coordinate axes themselves. Getting this point? Okay, so don't be like, oh, what will happen now? My A is equal to B. I don't know what to do in this formula. Everything becomes undefined. Nothing to panic. You just A equal to B means X square minus Y square equal to zero is your pair of bisectors. H equal to zero means XY equal to zero is your pair of bisectors. Yeah, sure, Karthik. See, what do I mean is when you say A is equal to B, this expression would have become like this, isn't it? Okay. Just take the zero on the other side and write it as X square minus Y square equal to zero. So that's how you get this equation. It should not give you a feeling that you're dividing by zero, which is not defined and all. It is just a symbolic representation. It just says it doesn't depend, your pair of bisectors doesn't depend on H. It is just trying to say that. Similarly, if your H is zero, it says it doesn't depend upon your A and B. It will definitely be your X and the Y axes. Getting my point? Okay, so with this, we are good to take some questions. Let's have a few questions. Okay, let me start with the easiest one. Hope you can read this. Find the equation of the bisector of the lines. If it is hidden, let me rewrite it for you. 3x squared minus 5xy plus 4y square equal to 0. Quickly.
Combined equation.
Combined equation, always. See, the equation of the bisectors, combined equation we want. Let me know once you're done, or you can type it out on the chat box also. Okay. Chaitanya done. Ruchir, why 25x square? Can you check that out once, please? Correct. Ruchir Mittal is correct. No, Ruchir Mittal also some mistake. Check it out. Mahit is correct. Mahit is correct. Param is correct. Yeah, guys, this is very simple formula based. No brainer. So you just have to write x square minus y square by a minus b. A minus b is 3 minus 4 is equal to xy by h. H is minus 5 by 2, my dear. Don't do those mistakes. Okay. So you can write 5 by 2 x square minus y square is equal to xy. So you can say 5x square minus 5y square minus 2xy equal to 0. This is your final answer. Okay, simple.
So in the formula, is it xy by h or xy by h square?
Xy by h.
H, oh.
Yeah. Okay. This is the formula. I'll write it down here also. X square minus y square by a minus b is equal to xy by h. Okay. Yeah, those who have made a mistake, now you know where you went wrong. Let's have one more question. Okay, here you go. So the question reads like this. If pairs of straight lines x square minus 2pxy minus y square equal to 0 and x square minus 2qxy minus y square equal to 0 be such that each pair bisects the angle between the other pair. In other words, one of them is the pair of bisectors for the other one. Okay. Then prove that PQ is equal to 1. This can come as an objective question also. Then they can ask, then PQ is which of the following?
So it basically means that the like the lines constituting the first equation are bisectors for the lines constituting the second one and vice versa.
Right. Yeah. And both of you can see they are perpendicular lines because the coefficient of x square and y square is 0 here, adding up to 0 here. And also in this case also, coefficient of x square and y square are adding up to 0.
Okay.
So it is a situation where something like this is happening. So these are the orange perpendicular lines. And bisecting them are two blue perpendicular lines, which I'm showing here. Okay. So even these two are perpendicular and these two are perpendicular. Let me know once you're done. Okay. Kritika, is the question clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Yep. Dhruv done. Hia done. Ruchir Singh done. Akansha done. But I'm also done. Anush also done. Okay, guys, most of you are done here. So guys, nothing to panic. All you need to do is just pick up the first pair of straight lines. So I pick up this guy. Okay. And I would write down the bisector's equation. So the equation of the bisectors or the pair of bisectors would be x square minus y square by a minus b. A minus b is 1 minus minus 1. Correct? Is equal to xy by h. H is minus p if I'm not wrong. Correct? In that case, this equation will become negative px square minus 2xy plus py square equal to 0. I'm just simplifying it on the go. Now, this equation that you have is same as the given equation x square minus 2qxy minus y square equal to 0. That means they're both the same equations as per the question. So what we can do is we can do a comparison. You can do a comparison of these two equations. So we can say the coefficients of x square would be proportional to coefficients of xy. That's minus 2 by minus 2q. And that will also be proportional to coefficients of y square. Okay. Now these two doesn't bring anything new to the table because this is always true. So we have to take this into our account. By the way, I have written P over here. My bad. That was supposed to be Q. Okay. So from the white circled expression, I can say, by the way, minus 2 and this will go off. So you can say P or minus PQ is equal to 1 cross multiply and hence PQ becomes 1 minus 1. It's a very, very commonly asked questions in regional entrance exams. So in CET, Comet K, BITSAT, VIT, etc. You can see this question reappearing. Okay, let's have another one. Yeah, let's have this one. Yeah, question says, if the lines represented by x square minus 2pxy minus y square equal to 0 is rotated about the origin through an angle theta, one in clockwise direction, other in anti-clockwise direction, find the equation of the bisector of the angle between the lines in the new position. You got the question, right? So one of the two lines is rotated theta clockwise and the other one is rotated by theta anti-clockwise. Then what is the equation of the bisectors of the new line? Ah, Advik, you got it. Correct, Param. Correct, Ruchir. This was actually a googly question. Yeah, you all are correct, guys. Well done. There would be no change in the equation. So it will be our regular equation that we have seen, that is x square minus y square by 1 minus minus 1 is equal to xy by minus p. Okay. We have already seen this, I think, a little while ago. So px square plus 2xy minus py square equal to 0. Done. Okay. Now, guys, we are going to move towards general equation of second degree. General equation of second degree. So now homogeneous one we are done with. Now we are moving on to the general case. So why not here? Will there be any change in the position of the bisectors if one is moving clockwise theta, other is moving anti-clockwise theta?
Nope.
It's an equal angles, right? So
no change will be there. No, here.
It's like the two lines are just coming closer together, but the bisectors will still be at the same point.
Okay. Okay. Now she has got it. Okay, fine. Thanks. Let's do one thing. This is going to be again a time-consuming topic. It's a good time for now to have a break. Can we meet at 11:05 now? So eat something. So we'll resume at 11:05. Okay. So 10 minutes break. Have something so that we can sit for till 1 o'clock the next 2 hours. Okay. Since this is the starting of the new concept, I thought I would give you a break now. Okay. So let's have a break.